Okay, so today we're talking about chapter 4, section 7, and variation. So what we're going to do today is we're going to figure out how to create mathematical equations given, you know, some words, some sentences, right? Of course, we did this back in chapter 1, but we're going to dive just a little bit deeper today. So in application problems, we are often concerned with exploring how one quantity varies with respect to the other quantity. Variation equations allow us to show how one quantity changes with respect to one or more additional quantities. In this section, we will discuss direct variation, inverse variation, and combined variation. We start by introducing direct variation. So the formula for direct variation, super simple. Y is equal to K times X. Okay. Now what this equation does for us is it is showing a direct variation between y and x. Okay, so of course you can read that in there. Okay, but if we were just to have some equation like this where it said y is equal to x, okay, if we have some direct variation, this is a direct 100% one-to-one variation, right? Which, you know, doesn't really do anybody any favors, right? I mean, a rabbit is a rabbit, right? But, you know, obviously, you know, the rabbit's speed could be directly related to like a cheetah speed or something like that. That's a dumb example, but you get my point, right? Because y is equal to x, all that basically says is it says that y is, or it says that, well, I mean, honestly, it says y is equal to x. You know, there's no other way to say that, I guess. That they are the same thing, okay? So that's why we need that K, okay? The K is what trips up many students, but hopefully I tried to explain why the K is needed. Again, because we can't have just a direct one-to-one variation, right? Instead, we're gonna have a variation. They will be direct variations, but there's gonna be some sort of constant, which we're gonna call the constant of variation, right? And that's what we're going to figure out mainly today, okay? Because we're going to be told all the what varies directly with what. We have to figure out what K is, and then what we'll have the equation. Okay, so let's figure out what I mean by that. All right, so this reads. Suppose y varies directly with x. Perfect. So if y varies directly with x, it's going to look something like this. And then of course, you know, it's actually just going to be the same old equation, isn't it? Okay. All right. That's it. All right. So that's the equation we're going to use. And we're going to and it says y is equal to 20 and x is equal to 8. Okay. So let's plug that in. We'll start off with a. Okay, find the equation that relates to x and y. So in order to find the equation, we have to figure out what that constant is. We have to figure out what k is. Okay, because we're told what x and y is, but we got to figure out what that k is, and then we'll have the equation that relates x and y. Okay, so here we go. We're going to say y. So up here we have y is equal to kx. So we're going to put y. We said y is 20, and that's equal to k, which we do not know, and then x, which we said was 8. Okay, well, this isn't too hard. Let's go ahead and just solve for k. We're going to put k on the left side here. So k is equal to, oh, it's 20 divided by 8. Well, that's 2.5. Okay, so that's the equation. That's it. Okay, so my equation right here. B, find y when x is equal to 12. Okay, so we're going to find b when y is equal to, or I'm sorry, when x. Find y when x is equal to 12. Okay, oh, well, that's not my equation. Hang on. I got a little ahead of myself. My equation is y is equal to 2.5 times x. Sorry about that. So that's my equation, okay? That's my equation that shows the direct variation between x and y. So I'm going to use that equation here. So find y when x is equal to 12, so we, you know, y is equal to 2.5 times 12. Okay, 2.5 times 12, well, 2 times 12 is 24, and then half is going to be 30. Okay. And that's it. That's direct variation. course, we're gonna step it up a little bit, but that's the gist of it. Actually, I take it back. We're actually not gonna step it up that much. All right. The only stepping up we might have to do is we might have to read the sentence a third time. That's really it. Okay. And I'll show you what I mean, because we'll get to it. So starting at the top, in example one, the model y is equal kx is a linear equation. However, direct variation equations will not always be linear. Okay, what we mean by linear is, we have that first degree polynomial, right? So linear, this x is raised to the first power. That's it. For example, if y varies directly with the cube of x, then the equation will be y is equal to kx cubed. Where it's a constant function, and apparently 2 is exactly that. Okay, but so let's go ahead and read the problem. It reads, suppose y varies directly with the cube of x. Okay, so yeah, it's the exact same thing. So y is going to vary directly with the cube of x. Okay, so we just got to write that out like that. Perfect. Okay, so now we're going to start with a. Okay, so find the equation that relates x and y. Again, in order to find the equation, we have to figure out what k is equal to, okay? But we're given, you know, the x and y, so it should be pretty easy, right? So y is 375, and that's going to be equal to k times 5 cubed, okay? Well, what is 5 cubed? Well, that's one of the cubes I told you need to memorize, so it should be on tap there, right? 5 cubed is 125. Alrighty, so if I divide 375 by 125, I should get 3, right? So k is going to equal to 3, right? And then since k is equal to 3, the equation that relates them, so let's make sure 125, 250, okay. The equation that relates them is going to be y is equal to, and then we're going to plug that 3 in, x cubed. Okay, so real quickly, for all these problems, well, actually, I won't say all because I don't really, I can't remember how the rest of them go. But for, I think maybe for all of them, at least for these first two, when we're finding k, okay, these numbers we're given are arbitrary numbers that tell us how to find the equation, okay, and then once we find the equation, that equation can be used for everything. It's kind of like this. Shoot, I can't remember if it was this class. But if you recall, we might have had a parabola like this, okay? And we might have just. No, that's definitely not this class. Right. Never mind. Either way, we're trying to find what that k variable is. And once we find the k variable, we have the actual equation. And once we have the equation, then we can go to work, right? So b reads, find y when x is equal to 2. So y is equal to 3 times, and then x is equal to 2 cubed. Well, what's 2 cubed? 2 cubed is 8. 8 times 3 is 24. All right, easy peasy. Alrighty, for direct variation, the ratio of the two quantities is constant, the constant variation. For example, consider y is equal to kx and y is equal to k cubed, okay? Of course, that's something we did. And this is just a breakdown of, again, a little algorithm that you may use, you may or may not use. Again, those are only two options, Tyler. Nobody's in here is named Tyler. Hopefully not. That's just always what's on my friend Tyler. Anyways, that's the algorithm that you can kind of use to follow along. But again, once you really understand what you're doing, you don't have to rigorously go step one, step two, step three, step four. Not for this anymore. So obviously I do have steps in other areas of my instruction, but not this. Okay, so now we're getting to the nitty-gritty. we're not told too much here, except, all right, so let's just go and read. I said, problems like this, the worst thing we're going to do is probably have to read it three times instead of two, right? So let's try that. The kinetic energy of an object in motion varies directly with the square of its speed. Okay, so it's a direct variation. If a van traveling at a speed of 30 meters per second has 945,000 joules of kinetic energy, how much kinetic energy does it have if it travels at a speed of 20 meters per second? Perfect. Okay, so this is, it's giving me two parts. Okay, it doesn't necessarily break it down into A or B or with two question marks, but it's giving me two parts. But first, let's start this out like we did the first two examples, okay? So let's reread the first sentence. The kinetic energy of an object in motion. Okay, so the kinetic energy of an object in motion. So we're going to make that be K. I don't know why my K's are awful. It varies directly with the square of its speed. Okay, so let's go take a minute out. Big K. So again, that little K, that's just going to be in there. It's in there every time, right? But it's going to vary directly with the square of its speed. So it's going to be the speed squared. Looks good to me. Okay. All right. So now this reads, if a van traveling at a speed of 30 meters per second. Okay. So it looks like speed is going to be a 30. Okay. 30 meters per second has 945,000 joules of kinetic energy. So my kinetic energy is going to be, I promise you, I know how to make K's, but I really feel like I've had to erase every single K. But anyways, here we go. Maybe I should just do the cursive K. 945,000 joules. Okay. How much kinetic energy does it have if traveling at a speed of 20 meters per second? All right, so we don't actually have the equation yet, so we cannot do the last part just yet. And underlining in yellow seems like a really bad idea, but I'm just going to keep that there. Okay. So first of all, we have to figure out what the equation is. Okay. So we're going to put a little bridge there. All right. So we're going to say, we're just going to follow along with this equation. We're going to say 940,000 is equal to K and then S, which is 30 squared. Okay, well, 30 squared is 900. We're going to divide here. We're going to divide 940,000 by 900. So okay, so 1,044. That doesn't look good. Well, here's a big reason why it doesn't look good. I don't know why. It's just this class, isn't it? For some reason, I struggle with actually reading the problem. It's 945,000, Sherman. Yeah, okay. Now we might get an actual round number. Yes, 1050. Okay, by doing this, we get the constant K is going to be equal to 1050. I don't know if that's going to fit on the screen, so let's actually not put that there. We'll put it underneath. Alrighty, so if K is equal to 1050, now my equation is now going to be, it's going to be big K is equal to 1050 S squared. Okay, now we can proceed with the last part. How much kinetic energy does it have if it's traveling at 20 meters per second? Okay, so all we have to do is solve for K, right? So in order to solve for K, and honestly, let's try, I wonder if green shows up better. A little bit better. All right, so maybe I shouldn't. There we go. All right, so 20 meters per second. So we're going to say K is equal to 1050. And then 20 meters per second, so it's going to be 20 squared. Okay, 20 squared is 400, so 1040 times 400. I'm sorry, 1050. Oof, maybe that's my problem. It's got a lot of energy. It's got 420,000 energy. Okay, and I guess that would be in joules, right? All right, and that's it. So again, this particular problem, we didn't have the A, B, right? But instead, we had to spot it. And I mean, I guess I read it at least twice. How about that? I mean, I think I might have maybe fudged maybe a third in there by just piecing out little pieces. But for the most part, again, the hard part of this is just figuring out what goes where. All right, so the ponderal index measure of leanness states that the body mass varies directly with the cube of height. Okay, so that tells me already what my equation is going to be. Okay, so the body mass varies directly. So the body mass, I guess let's put a big M. I don't want to put a small M because that's like slope, right? So the body mass varies directly with the cube of the height. So it's going to be equal to, and again, the K is always there. And then height is cubed, just like that. Okay. Alrighty, so if a normal person who is 1.2 meters tall has a body mass of 21.6 kilograms, then what is the body mass of a normal person that is 1.8 meters tall? So what we're going to do is, I like how they put normal in quotations, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to first figure out what that K is, again, every single time. Okay. So in order to figure out the K, the first sentence, the first measurements, rather, tells us that we have a mass of 21.6 kilograms. All right, that's going to be equal to K, and it's going to be equal to 1.2. It's going to be equal to the height cubed, so it's going to be 1.2. cubed. Alrighty, so that's going to tell me so 21.6 divided by 1.2 cubed. 12.5. So K is going to be 12.5. And then this is going to tell me that my equation is going to be M is equal to 12.5 H cubed. Okay, so I'm going to use that as my equation. So let's finish up the last part. Then what is the body mass of a normal person that is 1.2 meters tall? So all we're given is the height. So we're looking for the mass. So we're going to say M is equal to 12.5. times 1.8 cubed. Okay, and that's going to be 72.9. So 72.9 kilograms. Is that right? It seems like a large number considering what we've done. But yeah, I guess so. I mean, we did everything right. Alrighty. Alright, so I was gonna check my answer, but we're just gonna have to see and make sure it's right. I mean, I'm pretty sure we did it right. It's really pretty simple computation. 12.5, perfect. Put 12.5 in, 1.8. Did I read it right? Let's see. Give me a second. I'm gonna figure out. Okay, so 1.8 meters is 5'10", 5'11" ish, right? 10.8. Sorry, I don't know my metric. Not as good as I should, right? So it's about a, yeah, that makes sense. A 5'10" person, about 160 pounds, right? Yeah, we're good. I was just going based off of this mass here. Well, this mass here. All right, so let's go on. All right, so we now discuss inverse variation. Okay, so now we're on to the second part of today's lecture. Inverse variation means that one variable is a constant multiple of the reciprocal of another variable. Okay, so really quickly, there are two equations here. Okay, we're mainly going to use we're going to use the first one, but I want to break it down looking at like the second one. So if we were to read something that says something is inversely related, okay, so y is equal to, okay, so if we set it up like we do just a direct variation, it's going to be y is equal to k, right? That's how we start every time, all right? And then, of course, we would do x for direct variation. But if we're going to do inverse variation, we're going to put a 1 over what that inverse variation is. And in this case, it'd be k, okay? But of course, we know that k times 1 over x is indeed k over x, okay? So that's how we're going to do this. All right, we're gonna put the of course, put a little multiplication there. We're gonna put the k in the numerator, and then whatever is the inverse variation down there as the denominator. That's it. That is literally the only thing that's changing. Okay, so yeah, that's just going on. I think you guys want examples though. Okay, so we're going to start off with another simple one, but again, as I've said before, I don't feel like there it gets much difficult in this. I think this is a nice easy breezy section, considering, you know, how much how fast we have been going. Anyways, here we go. So suppose y varies inversely with x. So if we're going to say y, it's going to vary inversely with x. So remember that k is going to be the numerator, and then whatever my inverse is down there in the denominator. Alrighty. So and all right, so and y is equal to 72 and x is equal to 50. We need to find an equation that relates x and y. Perfect. So we're told y is 72. And we are told that x is equal to 50, so we gotta just solve for, oh, this might be even easier, right? We're just gonna multiply both sides by 50. We'll put equal sign for the, there we go. 3600. So k is equal to 3600. And if k is equal to 3600, that means my equation is going to be y is equal to 3600 over x. Perfect. So that's a. Put that in a little box. All right, now b, find y when x is equal to 45. Easy stuff. So we're going to say y is equal to 3600 over 45, which is 80. Right. So inverse, again, inverse variation, pretty easy stuff. You just have to know how to set things up. But again, it will get a little bit harder, I'm sure. Well, I mean, I know it will. Yeah. So we're going to be given an actual you know, nice good old word problems, things that you I know that you like. Here we go. So for a given mass, the density of an object is inversely proportional to its volume. Okay, so my equation for a given mass. Now, that's not part of the equation. The next after the comma is though, the density of an object. So we're gonna say the density of an object is inversely proportional to its volume. So inversely proportional, so we're gonna put the k in the numerator and to its volume. Well, that's pretty easy. Okay, good. Alrighty, so let's continue on. If 50 cubic centimeters of an object with a density of 28 grams per cubic centimeter, okay, so we're kind of told things a little backwards there, but it's okay because we caught it, right? 50 cubic centimeters is going to be the volume, and 28 is going to be the density. So we're gonna put 28 is equal to k over 50. And that means that k is going to be equal to $1,400. Perfect. All right. Now the next line, we have to figure out what happens. 50 cubic centimeters object. Okay, so now we're going to compress that to 40 cubic centimeters. Okay, so we're going to use our equation. I didn't actually write my equation, did I? So my equation is D is equal to 1400 over V. Okay. Now we're going to find its density when it's compressed to 40 cubic centimeters. Okay, so all we're going to do here, we'll put this in green, we're going to put a D, it's equal to 1400 over its new volume, which would be 40, and that's equal to 35. And I mean, I guess I didn't really actually talk that out, did I? Let's actually go back there. All right, so again, what I did was, you know, and I've done this honestly for every single problem. I have, you know, I've figured out what my equation should be, okay? And then I figured out what my constant would be in order to figure out what my actual equation is going to be, okay? So I've done that for every single one of them. This one's no different. And we got to the correct solution, and we did. Trust me. Yeah, 35. All right, so before we start this next one, it is a coffee sipping time. So everybody get your coffees and sip. Good stuff. So, same problem. It's always hot, right? Here we go. So the shutter speed S of a camera varies inversely. Okay, it's easy. So we have the shutter speed S, and it's going to vary inversely. So we're going to put a K up here, and it varies inversely with the aperture, with the square of the aperture setting F. So we're gonna say F squared. Okay, well that's easy. All right, if the shutter speed is 125, so now we're gonna do the thing where we have to figure out what K is. So if the shutter speed is 125, so 125 is equal to K over 5.6 quantity squared. This means K is equal to 5.6 squared times 125, 3920. So 3920. This does look a little off, doesn't it? So we're going to fix that. Okay, so this means my equation is going to be S is equal to 3920 over F squared. Perfect. And then we're ready to finish it up. What is the shutter speed of if the aperture is 1.4? Okay, well, what is the shutter speed? That's easy. We're just going to solve for S here, right? We don't have to move anything around. Even if we did, it's pretty easy stuff. Over 1.4 squared, which would be 3920 divided by 1.4 squared. 2,000. So shutter speed would be 2,000. Does it say anything? Does it, I don't know. It's just 2,000. 2,000 what? Just 2,000. Okay. Well, there it is. 2,000. All right. That's the shutter speed. So again, every single one of these, we're on example 7, and I'm pretty sure every single one of these I've done the exact same way, haven't I? So this is actually we do need to look at this. Right, so this is where we combine variations, okay? So for instance, if without even reading it, this one looks like it is a well, that one maybe not. This one. This looks like a that they all are actually. I'm sorry. We are combining variations. We're going to have multiple variables, and we're also going to be directly and inversely varying. Okay, and that's all it really means. Let's see, directly inversely. That's good. Okay, last sentence. It says when a variable is directly proportional to the product of two or more variables, such as y. And again, I would say if I would read this saying, y varies jointly with x and z. Okay, that's called a joint variation. In this case, we would say that y varies jointly, like I just said. Okay, so those are some key words. And again, we're going to start off with a nice simple one. We don't have to talk about any sort of meters per second or anything like that. All right, so this equation, y varies directly with w and inversely with x. So y is going to vary. Okay, so it's going to be y, and remember the k is going to be in the numerator, right? Because since we have that inversely. So it's going to be varies directly with w, so I'm going to say kw over x. Perfect. It is varying directly with w and inversely with x. That's how we do it. Okay. So A reads, find the equation that relates to W, X, and Y. So in order to do that, well, Y is equal to 240 is equal to, we don't know what K is equal to yet. W is equal to 20 and X is equal to 4. Okay, solving this, we get K, we're going to multiply by, yeah, we'll just do it. Get 48, so k is equal to 48. Okay, and if we set up the equation, then we have y is equal to 48 w over x. That's easy. So now, and then again, we'll put it in a box like we have been doing. Okay, and then b, find y when w is equal to 10 and x is equal to 3. So we're going to find y, so y, that's it, when w is equal to 10, so 48 times 10, oh, that's not a, times 10 over 3. So 480 divided by 3. Well, what's 48 divided by 3? That would be 16. So 6, so 160. That's it. Every single one of these, same procedure. Except I normally write that in green, don't I? Oh well, we're gonna not do that there. Looks like a minus 360 on that page, on it. All right, so volume of a conical tank. Okay, so this one looks like it's very promising to be awful. All right, so here we go. One moment, let me. All right, so the number of gallons of a liquid that can be stored in a conical tank is directly proportional to the area of the base of the tank and its height. Okay, so this is a joint variation. So the number of gallons of liquid that can be stored in a conical tank. So the number of gallons being stored, that sounds like a volume. Okay, you could probably put a G. As a matter of fact, I bet some people would. So we're going to go ahead and put a G just to kind of show that doesn't that not that doesn't necessarily matter, right? But that is that this is basically stating a volume. So it is directly proportional to the area. Okay, so this is good. So it's going to be directly proportional, so we're just going to put a K there. The area of the base, so how would I put the area of the base? Well, I just put a B, the base tank. And its height, and then height is just going to be H. And this is a joint variation, perfect. So this is it, that's it, all right? So here we go, same procedure. We have to figure out what K is. A tank with the base area of 100, or I'm sorry, with 1200 square feet and a height is 15 feet holds 45,000 gallons. So it is 45,000 gallons is equal to some K times the base we said was 1200 square feet times the height of 15. Okay, so this means k is equal to, right, so 45,000 divided by 1,200 times 15. So 2.5. Oh, that's okay. So k is equal to 2.5. That is my constant. So that means my equation is going to be g is equal to 2.5bh. Okay. All right, so how tall must the tank be to hold 75,000 gallons of liquid if its base area is 1,500 square feet? So we're trying to figure out its height. So how do I figure out its height? Well, we plug in all the variables except for height. So the number of gallons is 75,000 gallons. Okay. And it's going to be equal to k, we said it was 2.5. All right, the base is 1,500 square feet. And we don't know what h is. Okay. And so if we do 2.5 times 1,500 and then 75,000 over that, so 75,000 divided by 2.5 times 1,500, 20. So the height must be 20 feet. Really hope that I'm really driving the point home that these are very easy word problems, okay? So again, I know that your brain, again, because I was there, not that's nothing against you, I was there. I know what your brain shuts off when you start seeing word problems, but just give it half a second, and I promise you, I know you'll figure it out, okay? Because it's really easy. Electrical resistance. Alrighty, so the resistance of a wire. Okay, so the resistance of a wire, we're going to put that in. Normally it would be like ohms, right? Resistance of a wire. Again, you guys probably wouldn't do that, so we're going to go ahead and put a big R, because a small r we know is a radius, because I saw that we're going to be using a radius here. So the resistance of a wire, it's going to vary directly. Okay, so very directly. Actually, let's go ahead and read it, because I saw inversely. So it's going to vary directly with the length of the wire and inversely with the square. So this is going to be one of those where we have the k in the numerator. Okay. So it's going to vary directly with the length. So it's going to be length is going to also be in the numerator. And it's going to vary inversely with the square of its radius. So its radius down here is going to be squared. Good. And let's proceed. A wire with a length of 500 centimeters and a radius of 0.5 centimeters has a resistance of 15 ohms. So we're going to figure out what K is. So it's 15 ohms is equal to K. And then what is L? We said 500 centimeters. Right. And it's a radius of 0.5 centimeters. And then that's squared. So K is equal to, it's going to be 15 times 0.5 squared. Okay, so that's that. And it's going to be divided by 500. We're going to have a very tiny number. 0.0075. Okay, so that means my equation is going to be, my resistance is equal to 0.00. There we go. 5. That 5 looks awful. We're gonna have to make do. Perfect. Okay. That's my equation. Oh, did I actually put the last one in a little box? No. I like to try and stay consistent. Alright, so that's that. So we're gonna determine the resistance of an 800 centimeter piece. So we're gonna determine the resistance. So there's no moving around on this one. Determine the resistance of an 800 centimeter piece. So it's going to be 0.0075 times 800 all over 0.8 squared. So that's going to be 9.375. Perfect. Now, something I do want to point out. When I put these in a calculator, I mean, a lot of wrong and incorrect solutions that students get are because they put it into the calculator wrong, right? So what I like to do is I like to always put, when I plug it into my calculator, like this one, I would put zero, I would do open parentheses, 0.0075, and then of course the multiplication symbol, 800, close parentheses, division symbol, open parentheses, 0.8 squared, close parentheses. Especially if I have fractions, because the calculator is going to follow the order of operation. I'm pretty sure you could probably do this without the order of operation, because this, you know, these are just multiplications and divisions. But I always like to be overly redundant when it comes to putting down my my parentheses. Okay, and I hope you will too. Okay, so burning calories. All right, here we go. So, for a fixed speed, the number of calories burned while jogging varies jointly. Okay, so we're going to be looking at calories burned. So we're going to put a big C maybe. Number of calories burned while jogging varies jointly. Okay, so it's going to be varying jointly. Okay, so it's going to be, it doesn't say inversely, so it's just going to be, you know, a linear equation over there. It's going to vary jointly with the mass of the jogger, so we're going to put M, big M, and the time spent jogging. So time spent, we'll put T, right? T. And that's it. All right, so let's proceed. So here we go. If a 100-kilogram man jogs for 40 minutes and burns 490 calories, so we're going to have 490 calories that we're going to be burning. We don't know K. The mass was 100. And the time was 40. Okay, so let's figure out what K is. So 490 divided by 400, right? No, 4,000, sorry. So it's going to be 0.1225. So my formula will be C is equal to 0.1225 MT. And again, I don't know if I boxed it on the previous page. Oh, I did. Okay, good. Alrighty. So that's that. How many calories? Okay, so now we can just use that formula. So how many calories will a 130 kilogram? Okay, so my formula is 0.1225. He weighs 130 kilograms. 130. He's going to jog for 60 minutes. And so that's going to be 0. I feel like I did so much calculator work today. Probably because I did, huh? So he's going to burn 955.5 calories. Okay, and I do believe that is the last example. It is. Okay, so perfect. We got through today's lecture pretty quickly. We went through 11 examples in 44 minutes. We averaged 4 minutes per example. I think it's pretty easy stuff, right? So that does conclude today's lecture.